this is where I planted a flag. It's a landmark, it's a reminder to me of God's faithfulness, even in despair and even in disarray and even in feeling abandoned. This flag is a reminder of how close God actually is. It's a reminder of what it feels like to actually just be in relationship with Him instead of trying to do my way into relationship with Him. This is where I realized I was tired. I was tired of striving. I was tired of trying. I was tired of church planting. I was tired of preaching. I was tired of ministry. I was tired of the ups and downs, the disappointments, the failed expectations. And this is where I decided I was done. I was done with everything. I made a decision as I chucked my keys across the parking lot and had a very intense conversation with God that I was walking away from ministry. No more preaching, no more serving, no more ministry. It was done. After 5 years of being a church planter and it never really materializing into what I had hoped or what I had thought, and working tirelessly and seeing little to no fruit, I was just over it. This flag, it reminds me of who God is and who God called me to be.
Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome to City Line Church. I mean, yeah, you can do that. That's cool. Love you too. Love you too. Welcome to City Line. My name is Troy. I get to be one of the pastors here, and on behalf of our entire church family, to you, we want to say, man, thank you for choosing to spend your afternoon with us. We're glad you're here, and just know this, that we're a bunch of people just like you. We got mess. We got, you know, different things that's going on in our lives. We're trying to figure out what it means to find and follow Jesus, and we don't feel that you have to be perfect in order to come and celebrate with us, to sit with us, to talk with us, to have a relationship with us. Actually, we're crazy enough to believe that this is the perfect place to be. Imperfect. So if you got some junk, if you got pain in your life, if you got some things that are going on even right now, we just say, hey, man, welcome home. Yeah. Welcome home. You picked a great day and a great place to be to join us. So we're going to kick into the new series called Summer Road Trip. We're taking you guys on a trip, a great road trip, not an actual one. We're going to be right here at City Line Church every Sunday, so don't go anywhere else. But we're going on a trip, and we're going to these places of significance in our lives and looking at these places and saying, man, like, what is it that God has taught us or is teaching us or can teach us through these moments? Because as we look at our life, we all have different places that hold a special amount of significance, right? It said, man, I remember it was on this day and this place that this happened, and or this is what occurred in this place is significant for me. As I think back and reflect on that time in my life, this particular incident in this particular location holds a special amount of significance. And that's true of us. It's also true of many of the characters that we see throughout Scripture. We see men like Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, these leaders, these founding fathers, so to speak, of the faith. And we see them building altars and naming cities and declaring God's goodness in these locations as a testimony of who God is and something that He had done in their life. Maybe it's the culmination of events. Maybe it's a prayer answer. Maybe it's a source of frustration that God finally showed Himself to be mighty in. Between all of those things, they place these landmarks, these flags or these altars there as to commemorate that particular location and say, God has done something incredible in my life from that moment. Right, and so we're going to take you on a journey. We're going to visit some places, some ordinary places, just like walking around the city of Long Beach, some extraordinary places that I won't get into because those are other people's messages, and I ain't trying to step on nobody's toes. But they're going to go to some ordinary, some extraordinary places to look at what God has done in our lives, and our hope is that maybe you have been in some of those same places. Maybe you're there as well, and God can begin to speak life into all of us through sharing our stories and traveling back through these places. So I remember for myself, 2 years ago was a very difficult time in my life. I was kind of at a crossroads. I was angry and I was upset and I was bitter because I had worked so hard and I had done so many things, and I felt as though God had let me down. Right? I felt as though everything that I had hoped for and everything that I was working towards, it kind of didn't turn out the way that I wanted or the way that I thought, and I was angry and I was bitter at God. Right? I began to pull back and disconnect myself from God. It became difficult for me to trust God with the outcomes because I wasn't satisfied with the outcome of a certain set of situations and circumstances. So I was angry and I was bitter and I was upset. I was dealing with all kinds of disappointment. And as I began to reflect on this time in my life, in preparation for today, actually, is that because I don't tend to think about that time a lot, but as I began to reflect on that time in my life, the story of Jacob began to resonate with me. I began to look at his story and look at his life and began to see certain things about myself that I wasn't quite comfortable with, and starting to see things about who God is in dealing with this and in talking about these things. And I began to say, man, God, like, what is it that you want to teach me through this? And looking at Jacob's life, Jacob was a man that dealt with a lot of disappointment in his life. See, Jacob was the grandson of Abraham. He was Isaac's son, and Jacob had a brother named Esau. And Jacob was the little brother. They were twins, but Jacob was born second. And so in that day and age, it wasn't like today where the baby gets all the special treatment, right? The younger sister or the younger brother, they get everything. I see some head nods and some smiles of agreement in the audience. So the baby always gets away with things. It's like, man, like, if you weren't the youngest, I could never get away with that. You know, you get all of these different things. I got hand-me-downs. Like, we have, you know, a little bit of animosity towards our younger siblings sometimes because of the way our parents treated them. But in this day and age, it was the older sibling, the firstborn son, that got everything, right? And so Jacob's brother Esau would have been the one to receive the majority of his father's inheritance, and he would have received a special blessing from his father. And Jacob was always kind of coming up second, right? And that's what his name actually means. His name is one who grabs the heel, and you can't grab somebody's heel unless you're behind them. When they were born, Jacob was actually born holding on to his brother's heel. He was always coming up second, and I can relate to that because I have an older brother who is more muscular and more handsome than I am. I'm just being honest. Especially growing up, through my awkward stage. He never actually entered into an awkward stage. It was kind of unfair. But he was like the popular guy. People liked him. And I always felt that I was living in his shadow. I was always coming up second. I was always kind of having to figure out a way to get what I wanted to get because it wasn't going to come to me because he got everything anyway. Like, he's my dad's favorite. My mom likes him a little bit more, if I'm just being honest with you guys. So, like, this is what I had to deal with growing up. So I can relate to Jacob in that. And Jacob, he realized that his life was going to take a direction that he probably wasn't necessarily comfortable with. So he decided to make his own way. And so Esau comes back one day, and he's hungry after being out and working and being in battle, and he's hungry. And Jacob comes up to him, and knowing that his brother isn't the most forward-thinking individual on the planet, he says, hey, I see you're hungry. I'll trade you your inheritance for some soup. And Esau, being the not forward-thinking individual, agreed to these deals. He decided to give up his inheritance for a meal. Like, he decided to give up everything that his father had planned for him in order to have something that was a quick fix, right? He had a quick fix right there. So Jacob, he got one over on his brother. He hustled his way into an inheritance that wasn't initially his. But that wasn't enough for Jacob. He wasn't satisfied with just the birthright. He decided he wanted the blessing as well, because the blessing was essentially the direction and the purpose that God would have for his life, that his father would speak over him, and that was the direction his life would go in. And so Esau, being the older brother, would have gotten the better blessing. And so Jacob, knowing this, decides that he's going to deceive his father into giving him Esau's blessing. So one day, as his father is old in age and he can't really see very well, and he's probably a little off, you know, how, like, when you get that old, sometimes that might happen. So Jacob goes into the room and he puts sheepskin, you know, sheep wool on his arms, and he goes in and he disguises his voice and he tries to mimic his brother, and he says, hey, hey, dad. It's probably how he said it. He's like, hey, dad, it's me, Esau. And Isaac is like, I'm not quite sure that you're Esau. He's like, no, it's me, Esau. Touch my arms, right? And so he touches, he's like, oh, you must be Esau. You have hairy arms. Who else could it be? So he does this, right? And Isaac actually prays a blessing over Jacob. He prays this blessing over him and says, hey, like, you're going to be blessed. Your brother's going to serve you. Those who bless you will be blessed. Those who curse you will be cursed. You're going to have all these great and amazing and incredible things. He blessed him, and he set a direction for his life. Well, moments later, Esau comes into the room. And he is ready to receive the blessing from his father. And he says, hey, like, Dad, I'm ready for my blessing. And to which Isaac responds, well, weren't you just in here 5 minutes ago? He's like, no, that wasn't me. And they realize what had happened. And Esau gets upset, right? Have you ever been in a situation where your younger sibling, like does something to you and you get so upset, you're like, I want to kill him. Right? You ever been there? Like, I want to get him. Maybe you're not going to actually kill him. Well, Esau was probably actually going to kill Jacob. So Jacob runs away. He runs away and he goes and he finds a relative of his named Laban, and he goes and he lives with Laban, and that's where we find Jacob as he is living with Laban. In Genesis chapter 29, if you're following along in your notes, it reads as such. After Jacob had stayed with him for a whole month, Laban said to him, well, just because you're a relative of mine, should you work for me for nothing? Tell me what your wages should be. Now Laban had two daughters. The name of the older was Leah, and the name of the younger was Rachel. Leah had weak eyes, but Rachel had a lovely figure and was beautiful. Jesus, this is what someone said in agreement with the word of God. Jacob was in love with Rachel and said, I worked for you for 7 years in return for your younger daughter, Rachel. So Jacob finds himself at Laban's house, and Laban is his uncle, and he sees Rachel, who's Laban's daughter, and I know what you're thinking, that's some weird Game of Thrones type stuff. Yes, it is. However, there weren't that many people around back then, so your options were limited, okay? So he goes and he sees Rachel, and he's like, man, she is so fine. She is so beautiful. I got to make her mine. And so he decides, like, man, I'm a work. I'm going to put in work, and I'm going to get this woman. And they were in love with each other. And so Jacob, he says, hey, I worked for you for 7 years. I worked 7 years, right? And then you'll give me my bride. So they come to an agreement. They shake hands on it. Like, it's good. It's set in stone. So he goes and he does this thing, right? And so Laban says, yeah, it's better for me that I give her to you than some other guy. Stay here with me. So Jacob served 7 years to get Rachel. But they seemed like only a few days because of his love for her. Aww. Just a few days because of his love, right? It's so beautiful, so amazing, so incredible. Jacob, he was working and he had purpose. Right? Something that was there that made him alive. Like, he had a reason to get up every morning to go and work in the fields and attend those sheep, because he knew at the end of his term, at the end of 7 years, he was going to get the woman that he desired. He was going to get to have his beautiful wife. All of it was going to be worth it. So 7 years seemed like only a few days. I know what that's like. I made my wife work 6 years before I proposed. She was a little impatient, so I couldn't go to the seventh. No, I'm kidding. No, but I can relate to Jacob, not the 7 year thing, but I can relate to Jacob, because 7 years ago in my life, I actually made a decision to be part of a church plant. Right? I made a decision to leave the church that I was at and to go and do this thing called, like, we're starting a church from scratch with nothing. Like, we're going to start a church. And I was excited about it, because all of my hopes and my dreams and my goals in ministry is like, this was finally the point in time where I was going to take that step and God was going to do what he had called me. I was going to do what God had called me to do. And God's promises were there. They were right in front of me. I see his plan perfectly laid out. I'm going to go and I'm going to plant this church. And the people who were with me, they were family. They were close to me. I love them. Like, and we were doing this amazing and incredible thing. Like, we were planning a church, we had purpose, we had vision, we had goals in mind, we had dreams, and it was an amazing and incredible time. Even through the difficulties of church planning, right? Even through the difficulties of waking up at 6 o'clock in the morning on a Sunday and loading up a trailer and driving it out to a location and unloading the whole sound system and setting things up and chasing away roaches and rats out of the building and, like, doing all of these things, like, it was worth it. It was worth it. It didn't seem like work because it was ministry, because I was partnering with God and what he was doing. I was so passionate. I was on fire. I'm like, God, this is what you have called me to do. This is what my life is going to look like for the next, I don't know how many years, but I'm with you in this. I'm going to do this thing, right? I was excited about it. I had purpose. I had vision. I had drive. It was amazing. It was some of the best years of my life. It was hard, but it didn't feel like work. And I imagine that's how Jacob felt as he was working, getting up every day, knowing that he was one day closer to having his bride, that he was one day closer to having the thing that he was working towards. I imagine that's how Jacob had felt. But here's the thing. Jacob didn't quite get what he had hoped for. See, because if you continue along in the story, verses 21 through 25, you're following along in your notes. So at the end of 7 years, Jacob goes to his uncle Laban. He goes to Laban and he says, hey, it's time. Give me my wife. My time is complete and I want to make love to her. He said, I want to make this official. I want the thing that I have been hoping for, the thing that I have been working for. It's time to make it official, not just Facebook official, but I'm talking official before God and before man. You know, he's going to make it official. He's ready to do this. This is the culmination of everything that he had hoped for and everything that he had worked for. This is where his life was headed. So Laban brought together all the people to the place, and there was a feast. Right, there's a wedding. Everything is amazing. They're celebrating. They're drinking wine. They're having fun. They're having a great time. But when evening came, he took his daughter Leah and brought her to Jacob. And Jacob made love to her. Told you it was Game of Thrones type stuff going on. And Laban gave his servant Zilpah to his daughter as her attendant. And when morning came, there was Leah. Imagine Jacob's surprise. He thinks that he's with his wife the whole night. He thinks that this is the culmination of everything. He thinks that this is the ceremony of love that he had been looking forward to, that he had been working towards. But he wakes up and he looks over and it's the one with weak eyes. It's not the Rachel that he had been working for. It's not the thing that he had hoped for. It's not what he was striving for. It's not what made the seven works seem like only a few days. It's somebody else. It's something else. He had worked so hard and he didn't get what he felt that he deserved. And so he responds to Laban. He's noticeably upset. He says to Laban, what is this you have done to me? I served you for Rachel, didn't I? Why have you deceived me? Why have you deceived me? You see, 5 years ago, as we were 2 years into planning this church and doing all these incredible things, I remember this organization decided to come alongside us, and they heard about what we were doing and the mission of the church, and they heard the story, and they were all about it. They were wanting to get on board, and they sold us this dream, saying, hey, we have this much money to give you, and we can help you find a building, and you can have this salary, and you don't have to worry anymore. And I quit my job. I was going to school. I said, you know what, God, I'm going to take a step of faith. I'm going to step into ministry with both feet. I'm going to fully lean in. I'm going to fully trust you. I'm going to do this, right? And I'm looking, it looks like everything is just about to be paid off. It looks like all of my hard work is about to come to fruition. It looks like we're going to enter the season of harvest, right? That's what it's looking like. Everything looks great and everything looks good. The picture is so perfectly painted. We can see God's provision and God's direction and God's hand on the situation, and we see it. And I'm so excited because it looks like everything is finally going to come to pass. Like I was finally going to get what I had been working all these years for, everything that I had sacrificed for. It was going to be worth it. But then, in the 11th hour, right as everything was ready to be signed, right as everything was ready to be official, we get a phone call. We get a phone call from somebody, and they say, hey, I have bad news. We don't have any money to give you. There's no building that we can give you. We can't pay for extra staff. We can't come alongside you. In fact, something happened in our organization. Somebody stole the money, and we have to actually close our doors. So I'm sorry, but that's what you got. I was devastated. I was disappointed because I felt like everything that I've been working for had just completely blown up in my face. So I was disappointed. And here's the thing about disappointment. Disappointment is a part of life. We all deal with disappointment to some degree, some great disappointment, some small disappointments. And we're talking about road trips. You've ever gotten all the kids in the car, right? You've saved up the money and you've bought the tickets and you've set the dates. You've got the vacation time and it's been approved and you're getting ready to go on this trip and you're going to this particular place and everybody is excited, right? Everybody's excited. You're driving there and you get there, you get out the car and the first words out of one of the kids' mouth is, that's it. And you want to just reach back and touch somebody. You know what I'm saying? Lay some hands on some people. Right? It's like, that's it? Like, that's what we have been talking about? That's the place that we're going, right? Disappointment is a part of life. Sometimes we deal with disappointments in our job. We work for 10, for 20, for 30 years, and we're getting ready. Everything looks good. Our retirement is just right there. We can see it around a corner. We get called in one day, and the owner says, hey, we're going to have to lay you off. Hey, we don't have any money. hey, I don't know what I can do. Or you've been interviewing for a job, and you've been doing all of these things, and you make these choices and these decisions, and it doesn't quite go the way that you thought it would, right? You people talk to you, they sell you a good game, and they say, hey, we can do this for you, and we can do that for you. I can do this with your money. And what you come to find out is that you've done nothing. You've actually entered into a worse place than you were when you began, right? Disappointments, they happen to us. Or we find out something about somebody that we cared about, and it completely rocks our world and it changes our perspective of them, and we have to figure out what we're going to do with that, how we're going to move forward with that. We're disappointed in that. We're disappointed in them. Maybe we're disappointed in ourselves, right? But disappointment is a part of life, right? Pastor and author Charles Stanley, he has this to say about disappointment. He says, disappointment is inevitable, but to become discouraged, there's a choice I make. See, God would never discourage me. He would always point me to himself to trust him. Therefore, my discouragement is from the enemy. As you go through the emotions that we have, hostility is not from God. Bitterness, unforgiveness, all of these are attacks from the enemy. See, disappointment is a part of life. We can't get around it. We can't ignore it. We can't go through our journey of life and never arrive at that destination. It's going to be there. Disappointment is going to be there. But what we do, how we respond when we're disappointed, makes all the difference in the world, because to become discouraged, that's a choice that we make. To become bitter is a choice that we make. To become angry and upset and disconnected from community, that's a choice that we make. So disappointments, they're going to happen, but what do we do? How do we navigate these waters so that we don't become bitter, that we don't become hostile, that we don't become disconnected and upset and angry at God when disappointment comes? How do we deal with that? Well, I believe that looking at Jacob's story and even talking through these things, there's some very practical things that we can do to respond to disappointment so that we don't become angry, hostile, dejected, and upset. The first of which is we adjust our expectations. If you're following along in your notes, we adjust our expectations. Because aren't most disappointments the result of expectations not being met? Well, we have this thing where it's like expectations and then reality. Kind of like this. We have this expectation of this beautiful gondola ride through Venice and the canals. It's tranquil and peaceful. It's romantic. It's just you and your loved one and the person riding the gondola singing songs in Italian. And it's gorgeous. It's awesome. But you actually get there and you see the gondola and the canal is full of people and tourists and it's loud and it's messy and it's chaos. Or you have this one. Expectation. Reality. It's lunchtime, you're hungry. There's a jingle stuck in your head. Two all beef patty special sauce, lettuce, cheese, pickles, onions on a sesame seed bun. Right, and the image is there. You see the two beef patties and they're perfect and they're glistening and they're sizzling and the special sauce is perfectly contrasting the lettuce and the sesame seed is perfectly placed on the bun, each one in its own place to provide a delicious morsel of toastiness as you consume your Big Mac. I've thought about this a lot. So you drive through McDonald's and you order your Big Mac and you unwrap it only to find this sad beige, gray, pathetic excuse for a Big Mac. I mean, the patty is, I don't even want to get into it. It's not of God. It's not of God. Or you have this. My Pinterest fans in the house. It's Saturday morning. Dad wants to make breakfast for the kids. He gets up, he says, I'm gonna make bunny pancakes because that's what dads say on Saturdays. Trust me, I know. So he makes the pancakes and instead of this beautiful rabbit pancake, you get something that causes your kid to have to go to therapy for the next 18 years. Nightmare rabbit murder pancake. There you have it. Stay off Pinterest. Expectations and reality. Right, sometimes we have to adjust our expectations. We have to adjust our expectations, just as Jacob had to adjust his expectations when he woke up and he found that it was Leah that he had actually been married to. And he went to have a conversation with Laban. He said, hey, well, you can work another 7 years and I'll give you Rachel too. I mean, I'll give you Rachel right now, but you got to still work another 7 years. Right? And Jacob in that moment could have said, no, like, we had an agreement. He could have been bitter and he could have been angry and he could have took revenge on his uncle. He could have reverted back into some of his old habits and swindled and hustled his way to get what he wanted, right? He could have chosen not to trust God with the outcome, but instead he adjusted his expectations. He said, okay, I accept that this is the hand that I've been dealt. God, like, all right, I'm going to trust you in this. So he worked in another 7 years. See, a lot of times when things don't go our way, a lot of times when we're disappointed, when things happen and it's outside of our control, what we tend to do is tighten our control. Say, you know what? I'm going to do things my way now. I tried trusting you, God. I tried waiting for you, God. I tried listening to you, God, and it didn't happen the way I thought it should or I think it should. And so I'm going to do what I think I should do to work it out in my own strength. But we have to be careful because when we do that, we either get too far ahead of God or way off somewhere in left field, never following the plan that God has for our lives, which means we're never going to arrive at his greater. We're just going to continue to be angry and upset and disconnected if we don't adjust our expectations. Say, you know what, God, this is what you have for me. What do you want me to do with that? All right, the next thing we do after we adjust our expectations is we seek to learn from the situation. All right, we learn, we say, okay, what is it that I can learn about God? What is it that I can learn about myself as I'm dealing with this reality of disappointment? See, Jacob, he realized who Laban was and the type of person that he was. And so when he made this deal with Laban, the first thing he did is he goes and he asks God for direction, God for wisdom and how to deal with that relationship. So at the end of 7 years, he doesn't find himself in the same position he was right then in that moment. Says, I need you, God, to teach me, to show me what you would have me do as I navigate these waters. God, teach me what you want to teach me in this. And sometimes that's the hardest thing to ask, right? As things don't go our way, as we're faced with some difficult situations and circumstances, one of the hardest things to ask is, God, what can I learn from this? Because we want to still be hurt. We want to still be upset. We want to still feel the emotions, which are perfectly human and perfectly natural. But God is saying, hey, I still want to teach you something about myself and about you through this situation. I still want you to grow through this. I didn't cause it to happen, but I'm here with you so I can teach you something about me. And I can teach you something that will help you continue to move forward and to walk forward and to live into the greater things that I have for you. Would you please let me teach you in that? And then after we seek to learn from the situation and as we have adjusted our expectations, the next thing that we need to do is we need to connect with community. Another way of saying that is to grow your family. Now, Jacob grew his family the traditional way. He just had a bunch of kids. I don't know that having 12 kids is in any of our cards, but I'm not going to judge if you do. It's not in mine. But he grew his family, right? But God has provided us a family. He has provided us a church family. If you call City Line Church your home, or if you're visiting us for the first time, we want to say, hey, welcome home. We're family. God has provided us people who will speak life into us, who will come alongside of us through difficult times, who will encourage us, who will challenge us, who will lead us, and who will walk with us through some difficult things. He has provided a family. But the only way we live into those things is if we actually make the choice to connect with others. Where we have to choose to be a family. God can provide it, but it's up to us to reach in and lean into it. Where God says, hey, I have something for you, but if all we want to do is come here on the weekends and then live our lives saying, hey, man, nobody is there for me. Nobody wants to get to know me. God said, hey, I provided opportunities for you to get to know people. I'm providing opportunities for you to take next steps. Please, would you trust me and take that and connect with people and build and live into community? Because that's what's going to be an encouragement to you through some difficult times. Because again, disappointments will come. And after we do that, if we connect with community, he wants to challenge us to go deeper in our relationship with God, to lean in, to learn more about him, to trust him more. As Charles Stanley said, God doesn't bring us discouragement. He actually wants to point us towards him so we can trust him more. He wants to point us towards him, but it's difficult because it feels like and it seems like God is the one who let us down. Right? Because we think God is in control. Why would you do this to me? Why would you let this happen? So sometimes, I know this is true of myself, my tendency is to begin to pull back and to disconnect and to trust God less. When God is saying, hey, I want you to trust me more in this. I want to show you more of who I am. I want to show you more of my goodness. I want to show you more of my faithfulness. I want to show you more of how I'm a comforter. So would you please lean into your relationship with me instead of disconnecting and pulling back? This is what Jacob did. He began to lean into his relationship with God. He began to seek God as he's working, as he is shepherding, as he is growing his family. He continues to seek God. And actually, as his relationship with God deepened, his character began to transform. See, Jacob became less like Laban, less a deceiver, and more like somebody who God could trust to move forward with his plan and with his purpose. And then after we go deeper in our relationship with God, we stay focused on the big picture. See, because Jacob, through all the ups and downs of life and living with Laban and being disappointed, he held on to the blessing that was prayed over him. He held on to the truth that God spoke in his life. He held on to the promises of God, knowing that they are yes and amen. He continued to hold on to those promises and say, you know what? Even though things don't look quite right, even though I don't know what's going on, even though the waters are choppy and rocky, I can still trust in God because I know the words that he has spoke, they will come to pass. I know the God that I serve is faithful. I know the God that I serve is just. I know the God that I serve is true. And by God, I am not going to walk away from him. I'm going to lean in. I'm going to stay focused on the big picture, knowing that I'm a part of God's plan and I'm partnered with him and I'm in relationship with him and he will not fail me. Right? We're still partnering with God in his church. No matter what happens in our life, no matter the disappointments, no matter hell or high water, we'd be encouraged by this, that God is still with us. He is with us in the trials. He is with us in the valley. He is with us on the mountain through disappointment, through rejection, through dejection, through addiction. God is still with us. He wants to walk with us through those things. And if I'm being honest with you guys, I wish that I could stand before you and say that that's exactly what I did. I wish that I could stand before you and say, I trusted God with the outcome. I wish that I could stand before you and say, I adjusted my expectations. I wish I could stand before you and say that I connected with community, that I continue to go deeper in my relationship with God and I stay focused on the bigger picture, but that's not true. That's not what I did. See, because what I said to God was the very thing that Jacob said to Laban. My response to God in this situation for years was, why? What is this that you have done to me? I served you, didn't I? So why have you deceived me? For years, I would say that to God. I said, why did you deceive me? I gave up this for you. I made this choice for you. I was a part of your church. I did all of these things. I was serving you, wasn't I? So why would you deceive me? Why would you pull the curtain from under me? Why would you trick me? Why would you reject me? Why would you let me down in the way that you did? God, why would you do that to me? See, instead of adjusting my expectations, I actually became bitter. I became bitter because I continued to point and to think about what could have been. I continue to say, God, it should have been this way, but it wasn't. God, this should have happened, but it didn't, and I'm blaming you for it. You bear the brunt of the responsibility, God, because you let me down. I didn't adjust my expectations, and I didn't learn from the situation. I actually, instead of learning, started pointing fingers at other people, saying it's their fault that this happened. It's your fault that this happened. It was your sin. You did this to me. You hurt me. You did this. And instead of saying, God, what can you teach me about this? I said, God, you need to work on them. God, you need to do something in their life because they jacked up. They tow up from the flow up, God. Am I the only one that feels that way? All right, then. Don't judge me. No. You know, instead of connecting with community, I actually began to disconnect from everybody. Instead of being honest and open with the people who were around me, who loved me, who cared about me, I actually began to put up the mask, right? Smile. Do everything, but in the inside, I was angry, I was upset, I was disconnected. Nobody knew what I was really going through. I didn't trust anybody with what was actually happening to me. I was upset, and so I disconnected. I pulled back. I didn't have deep relationships with anybody. I wouldn't even be open and completely honest with my wife about the things that I was going through. And what I found out a few years later is that she was going through the very same things, and we could have become encouraged by suffering together, but instead, I decided to suffer alone. I decided to disconnect so much so that 5 years ago, almost to the day, I was in Oregon with some friends for a wedding. Not just casual friends, good friends. So, and everybody is sitting there and they're talking and we're all, you know, wide-eyed, bushy-tailed 20-somethings that are, you know, finishing up college and excited about the things that God has for us. And we're talking about life and talking about all of these different things. And they're, you know, sharing stories and being excited and encouraging one another and praying for one another. And I'm just kind of there. I'm just present, but not really participating. Because I'm literally, the wound was still fresh. It literally had just happened maybe a few months before, so I was still upset. I was in the beginning stages of my anger and my bitterness towards God. And I remember, actually, something like tugging me to share what I was going through and to talk about what I was going through. So I began to bear my soul, I began to talk about these things that were happening and how I was frustrated and hurt and feeling angry at God and these, you know, and all of this stuff. And I'm sharing this. And I was talking like, I am mad at God because why would he do this to me? This is what I'm saying. And I remember Megan was out there. Her and Austin were with me in this moment. And I remember her looking over and saying, what if God is just as hurt and he's with you in that? I remember that speaking to my heart. And I wish I could tell you that I left and I continued to pursue a relationship with God. And I started doing things the right way, but I didn't. It's not what happened. I stayed angry and I stayed bitter and I stayed upset because I never actually sought God's direction. I never trusted him with the outcome anymore because he had failed me in my estimation, that God had come up short. So I was like, I can't trust him with the outcome. I'm going to work it out in my own power and in my own strength and with my own wit. I'm going to manipulate the situation and do what I need to do because nobody else is looking out for me. So I got to look out for me. And so I began to do what I felt I needed to do to move forward. And instead of going deeper in my relationship with God, I put up walls. I started to disconnect myself from God. I started to pull back in my relationship with God. I would only seek him and I would only pray so I could get a message to give the students that I was helping to lead at that time in my life. And I didn't want to pursue a life-giving relationship with Jesus because I knew that's what he wanted and he hurt me. So my goal was to hurt him back. Instead of focusing on the big picture, I distracted myself with tasks. I started doing a lot of things that I didn't want to focus on the pain. I didn't want to focus on the hurt. I didn't want to get stuck and mired in the details and everything that was going on that wasn't right, that kept getting messed up. So I distracted myself and I just continued to work like Jacob did. He said he worked another 7 years. I said, you know, I'm just going to work. I'm just going to do this thing. I'm just going to set up every day. I'm just going to continue to serve. I'm just going to continue to do these things without any passion, without any joy, without any purpose, without any vision. I'm just going to kind of go through the motions and do all of these tasks to distract myself from the reality that I'm still dealing with disappointment and I'm angry and I'm hurt and I'm upset. And as the years went on, the joy that I have for serving God and being part of his church, it began to fade. I became more and more disconnected, and my relationship with God was basically non-existent. I went from being excited on Sunday mornings to serve God. I went from my jam. You know, we talked about that's my jam. My jam used to be I was glad when they said unto me, come, let us go into the house of the Lord. I was excited on Sunday mornings because I was doing something that had meaning. I was doing something that had purpose. I used to be excited about it. I used to be excited about serving people, about setting up tables and sound systems and shaking hands and preaching to people and loving on people. I was excited about it. But at some point in my life, I began to be upset and disconnected and angry and bitter. So my jam went from I was glad when they said unto me to something more along the lines of Psalm 142 was when I look beside me, I see that there is no one to help me. No one is to protect me and no one cares for me. That's literally how I felt for years. And that's why I gave up. That's why I found myself in a parking lot throwing my keys as far as I could. And having a conversation with God that was long overdue. Saying some things that I wish in some respects I could take back, but I'm also glad that I was finally able to open up about. That's when I decided I was done. I was done actively serving in a church. I didn't want to deal with the disappointments anymore. I didn't want to deal with the people anymore. I didn't want to deal with the tension, the relationships, the disappointments, the rejection. I don't want to deal with any of that anymore. I was just over it. I was done. And I was alone. And I felt that nobody cared about me. And then one day, I got in my car to go for a drive. I just got in my car and I said, you know what, I just need to clear my head. I just need to drive. I need to just get in my car and go. And so I got in my car and I began to drive. And what I realized about 5 minutes into it is I was heading in a very specific direction. I hadn't intended to go to this place. I literally was just going to drive and let, like, wherever the wind takes me, whatever that means. But I was just getting in my car and I'm driving. And as I realized where I was headed, I wasn't actually headed to a place. I was headed to a person. So I made a phone call to that person. It was the only person besides my wife that I could think of and some family that I can think of that actually cared about me. It was somebody that I knew didn't want anything from me, only wanted something for me. So I made a phone call, and it was something that I probably should have done 5 years before, but I was doing it in that moment. And I was like, hey, I need to talk to you. There's a lot going on in my life, and I just need to talk to you. And so my best friend and my brother on the other end of the phone said, dude, come and see me. I'll drop whatever it is that I'm doing. I'm here for you. Words that I hadn't heard in so long. I'm here for you. And so we get there, and I bare my heart and my soul, and I explain to them what's going on and what's happening in my life. And thank God for people who care for us. Right, thank God for people who are willing to listen to what we're going through, who are willing to listen and to hear what's happening in our life, and that can speak life into us. Because as I began to tell him what was going on in my life, he then responded and said, hey, I want to encourage you, and I'm going to speak life into you. And he began to encourage me with certain things from Scripture, and he prayed with me. But then I thank God that he didn't stop there, because he then challenged me. We have to be grateful for the people in our life who will encourage us and who will challenge us to move forward when they see exactly where we are and how damaging it is to us. Right? So my best friend and my brother, he said, I want to challenge you to take some next steps. I want to challenge you so you can move forward, because you don't have to live like this anymore. You don't have to continue to be hurt. You don't have to live in the disappointment and the rejection and the anger and the pain and the hostility and the abuse. Like, you can actually move forward. I want to challenge you to do that. And so I walked away from that conversation feeling encouraged. And I remember I said, you know what, God, I'm going to pray. I'm going to seek you for the next step, which is something that I have refused to do for so long. It's like, God, I'm going to seek you. I'm not going to make a decision. I'm not going to move. I'm not going to step until I know that this is what you are calling me to do. God, I'm going to seek you. However long it takes, God, I need you to direct my steps. I even went so far as to fast. I love food, church. Like I love food. My bank account will testify to that. That's a difficult thing. So I made it to say, I was like, God, I'm going to seek you for this. I'm going to pray, and I'm going to fast and seek your direction for my life. And so my friend, who some of you may well know, his name is Austin. He was serving as a worship pastor at this church in Lakewood. City Line Church, I think, is the name now. It was different in those days. I remember he said, Troy, because I love you, I'm going to tell you these things. He said, I want to invite you to come and just come hang out with us at City Line. And I was like, I'll think about it. I remember going home to my wife, and I was like, hey, and I kind of start talking to her about everything, and we're like, Austin invited us to come check out City Line, and we'd already known Pastor Jack and Linda and some of the leadership here, and you know, we'd actually come and hung out a few times, like on some other things, and we loved it. We loved the atmosphere, we loved the people, but we're like, it's too easy. It's too easy to go like there. Like, I'm gonna see what God has for me. You know, just kind of like that. Just being real. And so we've made a decision. So, you know, we're going to check it out, but it's not going to be our church. Right? So we come in on a Sunday, and I remember as the worship was playing, and we walked in, we sat where we still sit, well, before the baby, but we sat right here. And as the worship was playing, I literally felt the Holy Spirit flood my heart and my soul. And the invitation that Jesus gives to his disciples in Matthew 11 was so real to me in that moment. Because I could feel God saying to me, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your soul. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. You probably figured out by now that we stayed at City Line. Because what God was doing and is doing in this place is amazing and incredible, but it's not what I ever expected in my life. I had to adjust my expectations, and God brought me to a place of rest. He brought me to a place where I realized that he does care about me. And he placed people in my life that care about me, that speak life into me, that challenge me to continue to move forward through our leadership here and through the people here at City Line Church. This is why we call this church our home, because we have found a family. We have connected with community. It has enabled me to grow deeper in my relationship with God and with his church, and enabled me to continue to once again trust God with the outcomes in my life, because I am reminded of his goodness and his faithfulness, even though I didn't handle the situation the way that I should have. And it's actually enabled me to go back to this place that was a source of pain and hurt and unmet expectations. A place that reminded me of all the failures of my life. A place that reminded me not only just the failures of ministry, but the things that I felt that I had gotten the short end of the deal with my father and with my mother and with the way that I grew up. It was a place that reminded me of everything. It kind of all converged in this one spot, and I've been able to, by God's grace, go back to this place and in the ruins begin to rebuild. If the band would come back up. See, God in his wisdom and his grace, he placed the people around me. And we had to make the decision to lean in into that community. But he placed the people around me that enabled me, that gave us the strength to go back to the ruins of our life and begin to rebuild, to go back to the places and the times of disappointment and plant a flag that says, even though these things may happen, even though our world is shaken, even though our expectations are not met, even though all of these things are going wrong, the God that I serve is still faithful and just. The God that I serve is still good. He will be with me in the storm. He will walk with me in the valley. We will celebrate on the mountaintop. God is going to be with me, because when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Lord will raise a standard against him. That God is able to work together all things for good for those who trust him, who are called according to his will. Like, we can trust him. God is saying that I'm a good God. I'm a good father. I desire good things for you. Would you just trust me with your life? Would you just trust me with your pain and watch me do great and amazing things? Watch me lead you into the greater things that I have for you. So I've been able to plant a flag that continues to remind me of who God is. Even as we navigate the waters of disappointment. And maybe that's you. Maybe you're dealing with disappointments in life, maybe disappointed with other people, with the way things have turned out, even with yourself. Maybe that's you. I wanna encourage and invite you to trust God with it. To say, you know what, God, I don't quite know what happens next. I don't quite know what tomorrow holds, but what I do know is that you hold my tomorrow, God. You hold my tomorrow. I'm going to trust you with that. I'm going to lean in to community. I'm going to seek to learn from the situation. I'm going to go deeper in you, and I'm going to stay focused on the big picture. God, maybe it's time to step out and trust God with our outcomes. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I pray that our hearts will be open, God. I pray that we would have the courage as this time of reflection comes, God, as we are worshiping together with our family that you have put together here, God, that you have woven and stitched from all different parts of life and different parts of this world. God, I pray that as we are here today, right now, at City Line Church, that we would have the courage to step out and trust you, God. If we're holding on to some heavy burdens, God, if we're holding on to disappointment, God, I pray that we would accept your invitation to come and lay those down so you can take them, God, because you are gentle and humble at heart, and we will find rest for our souls with you. God, I pray that we'd have the courage to step when you say step, and to wait when you say wait. We ask all these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. I mean, as these guys continue in worship, we're actually going to have a space and a time to reflect and to celebrate this morning, because we have communion as our ushers are coming forward. You're more than welcome to take the communion elements as we are worshiping and reflect on who God is and what he has done for us. And I want to encourage you, if you need to take that step, make that step to trust him with your life. And we also have a time of celebration, because we have baptisms that are happening right now. Right? We have people who are choosing to say, God, I trust you fully with my life. And this baptism is a sign of that. So if you have signed up for baptism and want to create the space and time, you are welcome to go and get changed if you need to get changed right now. And if you've been sitting here listening and worshiping with us and you hadn't signed up for baptism, but God has impressed upon your heart that it's time to take a next step. It's time to plant a flag right here today on August 6th at City Line Church at 1:02 p.m. and say, you know what, God, this far and no further, I'm going to walk with this baptism. I'm going to choose to trust you with my life. I'm going to let the old go and the new come right now. We want to encourage you that you have the opportunity to do so today. So as they worship, we're going to take communion and we're going to celebrate the baptisms that are going to be happening right now.